Good morning, students. So this is lecture 5 of chapter number 2, the nationalist movement in Indochina, class 10 subject history. So we are at the verge of completing this chapter now, and till now we have completed the 5 series from this particular chapter. So we have covered emerging from the shadow of China. Then we have talked about the dilemma of the colonial education, hygiene, disease and everyday resistance, the religion and the anti-colonialism, the vision of modernization, and we have just started off with the communist movement and the Vietnamese nationalism. So in this particular lecture, we'll talk about this series only, which is series 6. And the topics that we're going to cover in this particular series will be, firstly, I am going to give you a quick recap what we have talked in the previous lecture. Then about this communist movement and Vietnamese nationalism. Then we'll talk about the new Republic of Vietnam. So how Vietnam have come up as a whole country, as a strong country, and represent the state as a new republic there. Then there was the entry of US into the war. How it happened, that we will talk about. Then the Ho Chi Minh tribe. So there was something very different came up. We'll talk about that also. That is there in this particular series. And then the homework solution that I've given in the previous lecture, and the homework that I will assign you in this particular lecture. So this is all that we're going to cover in this particular lecture. So just gear up. We are going to start with the lecture now. First of all, just let me remind you of whatever we have started in the previous lecture. We have talked about this one particular person, which was Phan Boi Chau. So his name was coming again and again. So who was he? Basically, he was a Vietnamese nationalist, and he formed the Revolutionary Society in 1903 there. He wrote a book also that was titled The History of the Loss of Vietnam. He wanted to overthrow the French rule with the help of the monarchy. So he was in the favor of the monarchy. He wanted to throw out French from Vietnam, but with the help of the monarchy system only. So he was not against this monarchy system. He was only against of the French colonialism that was happening in Vietnam. So he accepted monarchy. He did not want to revolt against the monarchy system. He accepted monarchy, but he never wanted to be revolt against this monarchy system, because he was in the favor of some rituals and traditions that the Vietnamese people have been following there. He wanted to get the help of monarchy to oppose the French rule, and he supported Vietnamese culture and opposed the Western ideas there. So he wanted to follow all the traditional forms of religion, culture that have been following from ages, and he was against the Western ideas, and he wanted to establish a constitutional monarchy there. So he wanted to establish a constitutional monarchy where these kings make certain laws and they are the ones that have to be followed in that particular state. Now there was one more person there, that was Phan Chu Trinh. He was also a Vietnamese nationalist there. But he was against the monarchy system. Why he was against this monarchy system? Because he wanted to establish a modern democratic republic. So he was in the favor of the Western ideas. He wanted to take country with the Western ideas also. So he wanted to establish a modern democratic republic there. He supported the French ideas of liberty, equality and fraternity. So basically, he was in the support of French from for few of the ideas, basically liberty, equality and fraternity. So basically, he wished to overthrow the monarchy. So he never wanted that the monarchy system should come again in Vietnam, and they should follow the same pattern, same traditions again. He planned an uprising against this monarchy system, and he did not want to get that help of monarchy system at all. He supported modern ideas like liberty, fraternity and equality, and he somehow succeeded in his job also. Now there was an influence of Japan and China on the Vietnamese nationalists here. How? Because Japan became a modern nation, so Vietnamese considered it as a model. The people who escaped from French police took refuge in Japan, and many students went to Japan in the name of education, but their real aim was to get Japan support for freedom struggle. So basically Japan was a modern nation there, and Vietnamese considered them as a role model. They took the help of Japanese people to escape the French police, and they want to go there in Japan to establish themselves. So many students went to Japan in the name of education, but their real aim was to get Japan support for freedom struggle. They set up Restoration Society in Japan and Sun Yat-sen's movement, which overthrew monarchy in China, inspired Vietnamese nationalists there. Now we come to the sixth series here, which we have started in the previous lecture only. We have talked about the effects of Great Depression on Vietnam. Effects spelling color hai. It is EFFECTS. So basically in this Great Depression, it led to a fall in the prices of rice and rubber. This affected the farmer badly. So basically the Great Depression led to a fall in the price of rice and rubber there. This affected the farmer badly. Export earning of Vietnam decreased sharply. So the exporting and trading system which was going on from Vietnam, it also decreased in a large number. Unemployment and poverty became severe. So there was a lot of amount of unemployment was there. Poverty was increasing, and it led to many revolts in villages as well. So he was Ho Chi Minh. So he started together with the nationalist group to establish the Vietnamese Communist, and he later renamed it into Indo-Chinese Communist Party. So he was the one who started with the party to inspire the Vietnamese people there, and to inspire the Democratic Republic, to help them to set up the Republic Democratic Society there. So Ho Chi Minh was the greatest leader of the Vietnamese freedom struggle there. So he was the greatest leader because he was united the nationalist groups and formed the Indo-Chinese Communist Party there. And he became the president of the North Vietnam and introduced many socialist policies as well. He founded a People's Army called Vietnam to fight against the foreign powers here. And he led the communists and the struggle for freedom for 40 years there. He organized his people for their heroic struggle against the American troops. So basically he was a great leader. He was the one who united the nationalist group and formed the Indo-Chinese Communist Party. He became the president of North Vietnam, and he has introduced many socialist policies. He formed People's Army called the Viet Minh to fight against his foreign powers there. And he led the communists and the struggle for freedom for 40 years there. He organized his people for his heroic struggle against his American troops. Now we'll start with the new topic, which is the New Republic of Vietnam. So the New Republic of Vietnam, which came up with this Ho Chi Minh, they have faced a number of challenges there. So basically what were the challenges? Now when they have got the independence, and when not the independence publicly, they got republic in one way or the other, the French tried again to regain the control by using the empire. So the French tried again to regain the control over the, Vietnam, and by using their empire by Vo Dai as their puppet. So there was a monarchy king that was in the favor of this French people, and he was revolving again and again by this French people there only. That was Vo Dai, the French used this person as a puppet there, and he faced with this French offensive. The Vietnamese were forced to re retreat to the hills again. So because of him, there were many again struggles that have been came up in the Vietnam, and they have to be retreated again so that they should abolish French as completely from their state. So after 8 years of fighting, the French were defeated in 1954 at Dinh Bui Phu. So basically that's a place in Vietnam there. So after 8 years of fighting again by the French people, the French were defeated in 1954 at Dinh Bui Phu. So the supreme French commander of the French army, General Henri Navarre, had declared confidently in 1953 that they would soon be victorious. So basically they were the commander of the supreme French army, the General Henri Navarre. He has declared in 1953 only that we will be the winner, we will have the victory over Vietnam again, and we will rule it there again. He has declared that way earlier in 1953, but on 7th May 1954, the Vietnam annihilated and captured more than 16,000 soldiers of the French Expeditionary Corps. So, but it all was changed when on 7th May 1954, the Vietnamese army, they have crashed the 16,000 soldiers of the French army into them, and the entire commanding staff, including the generals, 16 colonels and 1,749 officers, were also taken into prison. So there were many officials also they have taken into the prison. They have thrown them into jail. They have emerged as a strong army there. So the Vietnamese people emerged as a strong army, and they have defeated them with at most power there. So because of their power and strength, they that came up with this nationalist movement, they fought it out with this French army into some great struggle. So they have taken some new ideology how they can defeat the French army. So in 7th May 1954, they were able to do that, and they were had success of taking out the French army and French troops completely from Vietnam. So this division set in motion a series of events that turned Vietnam into a battlefield, bringing death and destruction to its people as well as the environment. So the how they took French away from Vietnam, so this division set a lot of series here. It turned the Vietnam into a battlefield where there was a lot of death that happened, there was a lot of destruction that happened to the environment and to the people who have been living there. So it was a great kind of a depression scene that was happening there, because there was a lot of death. It was kind of battlefield, basically what we call it as currently that we are watching Mahabharat time. So that was the one thing that was happening there at that time between the French and the Vietnam people. So the Bo Cai regime was soon overthrown by a coup led by Ngo Dinh Diem, and Diem built a repressive and authoritative government there. So basically there was one person who tried to overthrow this monarchy system also again from this Vietnam system. So they don't want to follow the monarchy system at all. They want to have their new republic of Vietnam there, and they want to particularly state government. They don't want to run by them. So anyone who was opposed him was called a communist and was jailed and killed. So many of them who was opposing this communist and movement and the communist movement that was happening there, they were throwing in them into jail and they were killing them. And Diem regained the Ordinance 10, a French law that permitted Christianity but outlawed Buddhism. So basically what they were doing in this communist movement there, that they made certain French law there that permitted Christianity, but they have overlawed Buddhism, which was the culture of Vietnam there. This dictionary rule came to be opposed by a board, opposition united under the banner of the National Liberation Front. So there was a certain laws that have been made for the favor of Vietnam and for in the against of Vietnam as well. So there was two categories that have been made now. So when all these things were happening, there was the entry of the US into the war. So how US came into this war was that US entry into this war marked a new phase that proved costly to the Vietnamese as well as the Americans here. So basically the US entry came up with a new phase of Vietnamese nationalism there. From 1965 to 1972, over 3,403 US services personnel served in Vietnam there. So they the Vietnamese people they took the help of this US Army, and from 1965 to 1972, over 3,403 US services were given to this Vietnamese people, and from where 7,484 were women only. So they were giving the help of to fight it out with this all the foreign communities here. So the US were kind of helping them. Even though the US had advanced technology and good medical supplies, casualties were high. About 47,244 died in battle, and 3,704 were wounded. And out of these wounded, 23,114 were listed by the Veterans Administration to be 100% disabled. So they were taking the help of the US Army, and the US also. But why this US needed Vietnam into their own country? Because they were quite advanced in technology, they had good medical supply. Why they need Vietnam to help them out in something, or what would can be the beneficial thing that could be taken from Vietnam? Because they were said they have advanced technology, they were having good medical supplies. Still, there was a lot of things that happened there, because they were kind of helping them, but their people died in that particular battle. Basically, 47,244 died there, and 3,704 were wounded there. And this phase of struggle with the US was brutal. So basically, this phase of struggle with the US was brutal, because the thousands of US troops arrived equipped with heavy weapons and tanks, and backed by the most powerful bombers at the time, B-52S. So basically this phase of struggle with the US was very much brutal. They came up with a heavy weapons here and tanks, and backed up the most powerful bombers of the time. The widespread attack and the use of chemical weapons also, like napalm. So basically they use napalm as a kind of a weapon there, and napalm was basically a kind of an organic component used to thicken gasoline for firebombs, and the mixture burns slowly, and when it comes in contact with surfaces like the human body, it shakes and continues to burn. It was developed in US and it was used in the Second World War. Despite international authority, it was used in Vietnam there. There was Agent Orange and phosphorus bombs destroyed many villages and rekindled jungles. Civilians died in large numbers. So this phase had a lot of brutal death, brutal struggles in villages of Vietnam and a lot more places in Vietnam. So the effect of the war was felt within the US as well. Many were critical of the government for getting involved in a war, and that they saw an indefensible system that was going on. When the youth were drafted for the war, the anger spread more. So the youth were also drafting and packing up themselves to for the war. They were also in a state of very angry moment because of the all these things that was happening there. The compulsory service in the army post, however, could be waited for the university graduates. This meant that many of those sent to fight did not belong to the privileged elite, but were minorities and children of working class families. So the compulsory services had been made in Vietnam for the young people who were living there, young students. So they at that time it was compulsory for each and every university boy or who was studying in universities to not even wait for their graduation. They have to do this army forces services, and they meant many of those to have to send to fight. Every time one particular batch is passing out and they are graduating, they are forced to get into these army forces, and they did not belong to a privileged elite, but were minorities and children of working class family only. So they were not given any privilege, elite facilities there. They were considered as minorities and children of some working class families there only. The US media and films played a major role in both supporting as well as criticizing the war. So what was the role of media and films here was they were quite supportive also, and they were criticizing the war as well. So the Hollywood made films in support of the war. So the Hollywood movies started making many films on this, such as John Wayne's Green Beret in 1968. So this film was based on the wars that was happening between all the things that was happening in Vietnam, and this has been cited by many as an example of an unthinking propaganda film that was responsible for motivating many young men to die in the war. So basically this particular movie was an example for the people of Vietnam to get these young men to motivate themselves to die in the war. Other films were more critical as they tried to understand the reason for this war. So basically other films were also made, but they were critically they were doing to understand why this, what were the reasons of this war that was happening. So Francis Ford Coppola's Apocalypse Now in 1979 reflected the moral confusion that the war had caused in the US. So this was again kind of a novel or a media session. They have reflected the moral confusion of the war that had been caused in the US. The war grew out of a fear among US policy planners that the victory of the Ho Chi Minh government would start a domino effect, and communist government would be established in the other countries in the area now. So the war grew out of the fear amongst the US policies. Planners have been made for the victory of the Ho Chi Minh government, and they started with the effect from this communist government that was established here, that should be established in Vietnam and the other countries in the area also. So not only Vietnam, the other parts of the country also should get influence from this only. They underestimated the power of nationalism to move people to action. So, but they were not, did not know basically the power of nationalism there to move them into action, inspire them to sacrifice their home and family and live under horrific conditions and fight for independence there. So there were many nationalists, they have underestimated the power of them to take certain actions, inspire them to sacrifice their home and family and live under horrific conditions and fight for their independence. They underestimated the power of a small country to fight the most technologically advanced country in the world. So they underestimated the power of this particularly small country to fight it out from with the most technologically advanced country in the world. Now there was one more trial that happened after this, was the Ho Chi Minh trial. So the story of the Ho Chi Minh trial is one way to understanding the nature of the war that the Vietnamese fought against the US. So basically the story of the Ho Chi Minh trial is one way of understanding the nature of the war that was between the Vietnamese fought against the US. It symbolizes how the Vietnamese used their limited resources to great advantage. The trial and immense network of footpaths and roads were used to transport men and material from the north to the south. So in Vietnam, what they were doing, they were using their sources at their as their advantage. So they know the directions of the footpaths and roads that were built there. They used it as to transport men and all the materials that they needed from north to the south. And the trial was improved from the late 1950s, and from 1967 about 20,000 North Vietnamese troops came south each month on this particular trial. So what they this trial was all about, they were taking advantage of their own particular resources, which they only know it. So they were using their footpaths, they were using their roads to transport their men, their material, and they improved it later after in 1950s when in till 1967 more than 20,000 people of North Vietnamese army persons were shifted to the south each month on this trial. So they started to shifting the army also so that they could fight it out with this war against this US. The trial had support base and the hospital along the way. So this particular trial has many support system. Basically the hospital were built along their ways. In some part the supplies were supported in trucks, but mostly they were carried in porters who were mainly women, and these porters carried about 25 kilos on their back or about 70 kilos on their bicycles as well. So basically the women were also helping them out to fight it out with this US army. They were supplying many weapons, many other porters there in not only single amount. One person was carrying 25 kilos on their back and about 70 kilos in the on their bicycle. So they were supplying a lot of amount of weapons and trucks, and they carried porters also in their back to fight it out against US there. So this trial was quite important. Most of the trial was outside Vietnam in neighboring Laos and Cambodia. So basically they took the help of the their neighboring state, which was Laos and Cambodia, which with the branch lines extending into South Vietnam. So all the lines that was going directly to the South Vietnam, the US regularly bombed this trial trying to dispute supplies, but efforts to destroy this important supply line by intensive bombing failed because they were rebuilt very quickly. So US also tried to fail their strategies that they have made. The US regularly bombed this particular trial to dispute the supplies, but efforts to destroy this important supply line was intensively bombing failed because they were rebuilding again and again very quickly there. So they were again assigning them because they were in a united form. They were not against with each other. They were working with each other to fight it out against US. So they were rebuilding it again and again against the US army there. That's what it is there in this particular series. In the next lecture we'll talk about the other series. So just a recap of this particular lecture: the challenges that have been faced by the new Republic of Vietnam. So the French troops tried to re-establish their control over Vietnam. So the new Republic had to fight a war, and Vietnam was divided into two parts in the Geneva Conference, where the USA entered into the Vietnamese war. So the new Republic had to fight against the most powerful country of the world now, and use of chemical weapons and destruction of towns and villages by the American forces made the people's life miserable there. battle of Dinh Vieu Phu. So it was a battle fought between the French and the Vietnamese in 1954. The French were defeated in this particular battle because now the Vietnamese army was stronger than the French one. Then there was a Genoa Conference of 1954. So it was organized by the UN community and it was decided to divide Vietnam into two parts. The north under the communist rule and south under the Bodine, the puppet of the USA. So in a UN community, they have divided the Vietnam into two parts. In the north, where the all the Vietnamese, the communist rule is there. In the south side, there will be the rule of the Bodine, the who was the puppet of the USA. So basically, the USA was ruling in the southern side. Now the National Liberation Front. So the Bodine's government in South Vietnam was overthrown by Ngo Dinh Diem. So basically, who was the monarchy person who was ruling in South Vietnam? The Bodine's government has overthrown him and he's set up an oppressive and dictatorial government there. Anyone who opposed him was called a communist and jailed. So anyone who was opposing his decisions, they were called as a Vietnamese or a communist person and they were thrown into jail. He allowed Christianity there and banned Buddhism. So he wanted to establish his own religion there and he banned the Vietnam religion there. So the people turned against him. They formed the NLF and started a war against his government with the support of North Vietnam. So the people who were living there, they were opposing him in a lot of way because they can't follow their own religion. So it started with the war against his government and they took the support of the North Vietnam as well. In the USA interference in the Vietnamese war. Now the USA decided to interfere in the Vietnamese war because of this Bodine government that was established in South Vietnam. Now Americans were strongly against this communist movement. They had a fear that the victory of communists of Vietnam would lead to a spread of communism in Asia. And the USA policy makers underestimated the strength of the Vietnamese nationalists there. They expected a quick victory. So the USA thought that they are quite strong. They can have the best of the army in the world. They can win it at any time. So the Americans were strongly against the communist movement. They had the fear of the victory of the communists of the Vietnam would lead to spread of the communism in Asia. And the USA policy makers were underestimating the strength of the Vietnamese nationalists and they accepted a quick victory. Effects of Vietnamese war on USA. So the American people opposed their country's involvement in the war and only non-graduates had to join the army. So many poor men had to go to Vietnam. Many Americans were killed and many were wounded. So their relatives turned against the government. Many books were written and films were made to show the suffering of the American troops there. So that's it as a whole lecture. Now the homework solution that I want to give you here is the question that I have given in the previous lecture. What was Phan Vu Trinh's objective for Vietnam and how were his ideas different from those of Phan Voi Chau? So basically the answer is Phan Vu Trinh's objective for Vietnam was to make it a democratic republic along with the Western ideals of liberty. He accused the French of not following their national ideals and demanding the setting up of legal and educational institutions alongside the development of agriculture and industries here. Unlike Phan Voi Chau, Phan Voi Trinh was extremely opposed to the monarchy system there and their ideas had at their roots this fundamental differences were there between these particularly two that I have just told you in this particular lecture also. What were the basic differences? So if it comes again in any of the tests or anywhere, you can answer it. Now the homework that I want to assign you in this particular lecture is explain the causes of the US involvement in the war in Vietnam and what were the effects did this involvement have on life within the US itself. So you have to tell the causes of the US involvement in the war in Vietnam and what were the effects did this involvement have on the life within the US itself? Question 2. Write an evaluation of the Vietnamese war against the US from the point of view of a quarter on the Ho Chi Minh Drive that we have spoke today itself. So this is the homework that I want to assign you, and mail me on my email ID that you all know. Still, you have queries, you have anything to ask from any of the related topics or anything else also, you can ask me on the comment section or in the student inquiry section. And if you want to have a one-on-one interaction, you can tell me on, you have my number, you can tell me personally that, ma'am, I want to have a video chat, or I want to ask directly some question. So we can have a direct session in on Cisco. That's a video chatting app. You can download that particular app. It is CISCO, Cisco. You can download that particular app to have a video chat. And please submit your homework regularly. Many of you are not doing that. I'm not giving you much of a homework, that it is quite difficult to do. It's just one or two questions that I'm giving you on a daily basis. So at least you can do this much. This is not a lot of homework that I'm giving you. You can do this much at least. So please do it regularly. Send me your homework on time, before the time that have been assigned to you. And just take care of your health. That is the most important thing currently. And take care of your family as well. So thank you. This is whole as a lecture. Take care.